Blackstone Audio presents In the Graveyard of Empires, America's War in Afghanistan by Seth G. Jones. To those struggling for peace in Afghanistan. Introduction. I spent the morning of September 8, 2006, with several Afghan friends in a guest house in Kabul, Afghanistan's capital, sipping a warm cup of sher chai, a traditional Afghan drink prepared using black tea, cardamom, and milk. The house was constructed of concrete, with whitewashed walls and a small leafy courtyard. There was a meticulously crafted assortment of red and pink roses around the perimeter, and a small vineyard with green grapes on one end. Like much of the capital city, this house had been rebuilt after the overthrow of the Taliban regime in 2001. Just 5 years after the American invasion, Kabul was a vastly different city, awash in electronics equipment and sprinkled with new internet cafes. The streets were clogged with bright yellow taxicabs, watermelon carts, bicycles, and cars imported from Europe and Asia. Young boys and girls shuffled to school along the congested sidewalks. Construction projects dotted the city. Several new banks and an upscale indoor shopping mall named Kabul City Center were going up downtown. Economic growth was up 8.6% that year alone. But there were ominous signs that the new order was teetering. At 10:20 a.m., a piercing noise shattered the morning lull. A suicide bomber had driven a dark Toyota Surf into a convoy of U.S. soldiers. I was in the vicinity of the attack, which occurred near Masood Square, bordering the main gate of the U.S. Embassy. The square had been named for Ahmed Shah Massoud, military leader of the United Islamic Front for the Salvation of Afghanistan, or Northern Alliance, who was assassinated by Al-Qaeda suicide bombers 2 days before September 11, 2001. The attack wounded 29 people and killed 16. Two of the dead were American soldiers. One was Staff Sergeant Robert Paul, an Army reservist from the Dalles, Oregon, who was part of the 364th Civil Affairs Brigade. In an obituary, his grieving family wrote, "He never turned down an opportunity because he always wanted to make a difference in everything he did." The other American killed was Sergeant First Class Meredith Howard, an Army reservist from Waukesha, Wisconsin, whose husband mourned her death by blasting her remains skyward in two fireworks displays. A few months earlier, an Army crew filming a segment on U.S. reconstruction efforts in Afghanistan showed Sergeant Howard handing out hundreds of backpacks. "Most of the kids are in school, even if it's just a few hours a day," she said. "And that's what we're trying to do, is just help them out as much as we can." The rest of the dead were Afghan civilians, unfortunate enough to be in the blast zone. One was an elderly man selling used clothing from a dilapidated rusty pushcart. Among the others were a half-dozen municipal street sweepers finishing their morning cleaning, and two gangly boys selling water. At the bomb site, I could see thick black smoke curling up the charred trees nearby. The blast had torn a 6-foot-wide crater in the road and left scattered over a wide area a gruesome and disquieting collection of items: Muslim prayer caps, khaki-colored military hats, shoes, and body parts. The explosion, which also had ripped apart an armored Humvee, was the largest suicide bombing in the capital up to that point. I tried not to be discouraged, but the trends suggested a growing insurgency. 2 days later, on September 10th, another suicide bomber assassinated Hakim Taniwal, governor of Paktia province. I had been scheduled to visit him later that week. He was a genteel, bespectacled sociology professor who had fled from Afghanistan to Pakistan in 1980, moved to Australia in 1997, and then returned home to Afghanistan in 2002 to help rebuild his shattered country. Afghan President Hamid Karzai had asked his close friend Taniwal to come to Paktia, a rugged province in the foothills of the Hindu Kush Mountains in eastern Afghanistan, which had become a hotbed of insurgent activity. Australia's Minister of Foreign Affairs, Alexander Downer, who knew Taniwal, described him as a scholarly, soft-spoken man of integrity and a good man with a reputation as a highly capable administrator. Taniwal's family had begged him not to return to Afghanistan, but he felt an overwhelming sense of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.